I'm Ryan Yamamoto. This is The Men, an investigation now underway into a deadly police shooting in Oakland. A homicide suspect was shot during an arrest involving Sacramento PD. It happened at a home at 16 and Adeline Streets when they say the man came out pointing a gun. The officers involved are now on administrative leave. A Livermore family was involved in the deadly crash in the Central Valley. CHP says the driver lost control, rolling over the van, and it caught fire. People ran out of their homes and cars to flip that van. Three children were rescued and are now in the hospital. The mom and dad and two children died at the scene. Well, today, remember 118 years ago on the anniversary of the San Francisco's great earthquake of 1906. This morning, city leaders and first responders held a commemoration event at Lotus Fountain on Market Street, where a wreath-laying ceremony was dedicated to the memory of the late Senator Dianne Feinstein. Brian Yamamoto, this is The Minute.
The system that's sitting just offshore, keeping us dry and warm, is starting to move a little bit to the south, but we're still getting above average temperatures heading into this afternoon by about 13 degrees just in areas like San Jose. And let's head over to the map real fast. I want to show you what's going on for our daytime highs all throughout the Bay Area. Upper 60s are expected today into San Francisco, with light winds sweeping in from the north to the south. To add to that, we're also expecting above average temperatures off near Livermore and Fremont. Upper 70s and lower 80s there, a similar trend down in the Santa Clara Valley. Now, the more north we go, closer to wine country, well, the more mild it gets, just by a little bit, not by much. 60s in the forecast for us near San Francisco, turns into 70s once you cross that Golden Gate Bridge into North Bay. It's going to be a beautiful one for us this afternoon. And let's take a quick look at what's happening right around the corner when it comes to rain. It's been dry for the past couple days. It has been perfect for any outdoor activities, and we'll continue to see that trend as we head into the next 7 days, with a slight chance of showers as early as next Wednesday. And we're keeping a close eye on that system right now. Looking at the Climate Prediction Center, they're showing wetter than normal conditions expected from our 8 to 14 day outlook. So a little far away, but it's worth noting that that's right around the corner, and that's going to break this dry break that we've had so far this week. 80s and 70s flirting back and forth. That's the forecast for us for our inland areas as we head into our weekend setup. Sunny skies for Sunday, beautiful as can be as we head into the weekend, and dry conditions to kick off next work week too. That's in our inland areas. Once we head to the Bay, closer to San Francisco and Oakland, it'll be just a little bit cooler, not by much though. 60s and 70s still kind of flirting back and forth, with a low 60s by next Wednesday, with that slight chance of showers still off in the distance.
Well, these light poles around Oakland's Lake Mare look pretty unremarkable. They're green and more than 100 years old. So unremarkable, though, you'd never guess that they are actually a hot commodity for thieves. And as Katie Nielsen shows us, they are so desperate for copper, some thieves are actually digging them out of the ground, and that's creating a big problem for the city.
We live here, yeah.
Michael Stadler lives only a few blocks from Lake Merritt and works from home most of the time, which is why he comes down to the lake sometimes twice a day.
Sunshine, a little bit of nature, and then the people. And I really like being around the people, and just it makes me feel like kind of part of the community.
But recently, he and others who regularly walk or run around the lake have noticed some of the light posts and string lights are missing.
I think I would feel more comfortable if the lights were up, but also my wife likes to run really early in the morning, and I think that does concern me more. I think I'm generally more concerned about her. Lighted spaces always seem safer. I think dark spaces just seem like places you can get away with stuff more.
There are 126 lampposts holding up more than 4,000 string lights that wrap around the more than 3-mile lake. They were first installed in 1925 and are affectionately called the Necklace of Lights.
The lake is our crown jewel, and I do remember when they put up the lights, and it was so beautiful, and I love driving by it, and it's magical.
Maureen Molman is a volunteer with the Lake Merritt Breakfast Club, a community group that cares for the lake and the Necklace of Lights.
I took great pride in them, and then when I started noticing they were down, I was very traumatized.
Yep.
Oakland Public Works employees were out at the lake putting up temporary poles and lights. The city says a total of 10 original poles are damaged or missing. Some of the poles came down when trees fell on the lights during recent storms. Others were vandalized, cut off at the base, and wires have been ripped out or damaged from 34 curb electrical boxes, possibly to steal the copper.
And in order to replace the light poles, the city has to have them custom made at a price of about $15,000 apiece. Well, the San Francisco Sheriff's Department is lifting the lockdown at a city jail. The facility on 7th Street has seen a spike in violence, and so has the jail in San Bruno. Partial lockdown is still in place at that facility. is expected to be lifted sometime this week. And on our morning edition, San Francisco Sheriff Paul Miyamoto spoke about the decision to lock those down and why they are now being lifted.
I think part of it is that as we moved on from the pandemic and gotten into normalcy in the jails just as much as we have in the community, there's a reflection of that in the behaviors that we see now. We've had an increase in violence against our staff, completely focused on our people. And the lockdowns are a way in that system in which we kind of calm things down, bring things back together, have the opportunity to investigate to make sure they're not tied to larger issues in terms of our housing units, and move on from there to keep people safe.
Are low staffing levels an issue when it comes to this?
Low staffing levels are definitely a challenge for us, but most of these attacks, and usually when deputies are assaulted, it's a one-on-one thing. They're targeting deputies, they're targeting individuals one-on-one. Some of these assaults have occurred with other deputies present as well and other staff. Our response times in the jails in terms of getting more help to people when these things happen are still there. It's not as many people, but there is always help on the way.
It's low staffing and then long shifts. We did report that even if you have those there, they may not be at their best in those environments because they're working those overtime hours.
Absolutely. That's a very big challenge for us right now. We're down over close to 200 deputies just in our entire system. We're down to about 75% staffing in each division. So it's very challenging for us to get people up to a level in which they feel comfortable because we are all human and we get tired working those long hours.
Well, San Francisco's district attorney wants anyone who has been stuck on the Golden Gate Bridge on Monday during those protests to file a report with the CHP. 26 people were arrested during protests that shut down the bridge for hours in both directions. DA Brooke Jenkins says anyone who got caught up in the protests could be a victim of false imprisonment. Meantime, we still don't know what's happening with the 12 people arrested during the protests that shut down 880. This happened in Oakland. District Attorney Pamela Price said her office is still waiting for the CHP to send them case information. In a statement, DA Price expressed support for the right to protest, but also said public safety should never be compromised. And today, we remember 118 years since San Francisco's great earthquake of 1906. The 7.9 magnitude earthquake caused a lot of devastation and several fires, which took days to put out. City leaders and first responders held a commemoration event at Lada's Fountain on Market Street. A wreath was laid at the spot, dedicated to the memory of the late Senator Dianne Feinstein and those who died in that devastation. Following the ceremony, there was a procession to the gold-painted fire hydrant on 20th and Church Streets near Dolores Park, where it received a fresh coat of paint. That hydrant was reportedly one of the few still supplying water at the time to fight the fires after the quake. And Sheriff Paul Miyamoto was at that fountain wreath ceremony. Take a listen to why he says this moment is so special.
We need everyone's help when things like that happen, remembering what happened so that we are prepared in the future for what will eventually be another earthquake here in San Francisco is something that's very important to do. This is a great commemoration because it brings back the history. It brings back the resilience that we experienced back then, the resilience that we're experiencing right now.
And San Francisco residents used Lada's fountain as a meeting point in the aftermath of the quake. Sean Jitnis has a look at some historic photos that can help us appreciate what the city went through.
Scenes from more than a century ago offer a snapshot into the destruction that consumed San Francisco in 1906 from a major earthquake and the fire that started soon after.
I'm born and raised here in San Francisco. I love our first responders. I love our history of San Francisco. And this was a great way for me to contribute back to the city and keep the history of our first responders, all the different departments, alive.
David Cruz is with the Guardians of the City, an organization that preserves the history of first responders in San Francisco.
Remembering our history, remembering the survivors, remembering those who perished is an incredible way for us to remember who we are as a city, how resilient we are as a city as we continue to move forward today.
And as events this week mark 118 years since the 1906 earthquake and fire, reminders of the impact on the city can be found everywhere, including the San Francisco Elks Club Lodge No. 3. It was destroyed in 1906 and rebuilt at the location it stands in today, a place at the time to help house survivors. This week, it hosts ceremonies to honor those who helped to protect pieces of that history, and even welcomes artifacts that remain a part of the collection. These events helped David to remember the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake, which has a lasting impact on him.
I lived here and I was a young child, and it was a scary moment for me. And that's what I think about if when the next one hits, what our community is going to look like, the type of support that they're going to need, and how we're going to continue to rebuild San Francisco.
The ruins of the city captured in photos like these serve as a window into the tragedy at the time. But volunteers like David with The Guardians hope history provides just as powerful a visual for all of us to be prepared in the future.
And still ahead on CBS News, Bay Area, a month after a family of four was killed in the crash at a San Francisco bus stop. Police were back out in that neighborhood trying to stop similar crashes before they ever happened. Plus, community groups around the city protest looming budget cuts, their message as the mayor weighs those deep cuts. And a new push to get psychedelics legalized in California. Why this effort seems to be gaining more traction.
Looking back, it's easy to see the unquestionable power of your stories.
It gets tougher. You get stronger.
When you put that positivity out there, it does multiply.
At KPIX, we're on a mission.
Come on in.
To go beyond news as usual. Because these are the people who connect and inspire us. And these are the stories that define us.
Our daytime highs throughout the Bay Area all week long have been sitting above average. But why? Well, high pressure sitting just offshore, keeping us nice and warm and dry too. And looking at the next 7 days, we're going to see a little bit of a cool down. But for now, just enjoy this warm weather while we have it. We're expecting upper 60s once again near San Francisco, with 80s off into the East Bay near Antioch, matching with Livermore, and more 80s in the forecast down into the Santa Clara Valley, lasting into this afternoon.
Well, it was one of the most horrific pedestrian accidents San Francisco has seen in years. A mom, a dad, and two young children were waiting at a West Portal bus stop heading to the zoo when police say a speeding driver flew through that intersection and hit them. The entire family died, leaving friends and family in mourning and sparking another conversation across the city about making sure pedestrians can remain safe on city streets. Well, now the city has given us a look at the changes they are trying to make on the road, which would prevent cars from cutting through that three-way intersection. While all this is planned, Lauren Toms reports on how SFPD are returning to that neighborhood to send a clear message that you must stop for pedestrians.
In the wake of a series of deadly crashes involving pedestrians, SFPD is cracking down by stepping out.
We need to do more traffic enforcement. That really was, that message was loud and clear. People run stop signs, they speed. They don't yield the right of way for people in the crosswalk.
Assistant Police Chief David Lazar is the bait. He steps out into this crosswalk in the West Portal neighborhood, testing drivers on whether they will lawfully break for him or skirt the law and speed past. And almost two dozen drivers were ticketed in just 90 minutes.
Pay attention to people in the crosswalk. Stop at the stop signs. Use your signal when you're changing lanes, like all those things to prevent collisions.
March saw a dramatic increase in traffic fatalities compared to 2023, which saw none. This year, there were seven.
The public needs to know that if someone is crossing the street in a crosswalk, they have to yield the right of way to that pedestrian. And I think we've all been in circumstances where you've crossed the street and a car has not paid attention to you. So we're really sending that message today that we're serious about it in our city, and we're starting with this location.
And a settlement has been reached in the case of Karen Cartagena, who accused of fatally striking a four-year-old child in a stroller on King Street. This happened last August. District Attorney Brooke Jenkins announced that the details yesterday in a statement. She said the case will not go to trial per the family's wishes and instead agreed that Cartagena will serve 400 hours of community service and complete a driver safety class with a driving condition until the class is completed. She added that she hopes the settlement will bring the family some solace as they work to heal and rebuild. Community groups rallied at a San Francisco City Hall yesterday to push back the proposed cuts to services that help families afford to live here in the city. Amanda Harry spoke with some of the people whose lives would be impacted.
Ain't no power like the power of the people, because the power of the people don't stop. Ain't no power like the power of the people, because the power of the people don't stop.
Support so that we can keep going.
People packed the stairs outside City Hall Wednesday to ask leaders to continue to look at their budget and not cut anything that would impact housing. The People's Budget Coalition gathered 40 groups that provide housing, food, and jobs to San Francisco residents. They want to see the city's budget continue to allocate funds towards critical services for the city's most vulnerable individuals, like Dexie Marina Baptista. She doesn't speak English and spoke with the help of an interpreter. She's an immigrant who moved here for a better life.
I'm here for resources because I live in a hotel with my children and they don't have room to play. We don't have the resource. We all share a bathroom.
They also don't have a kitchen and the family of five shares just one room. They live near 9th and Market. Only her husband works because she couldn't find work. She says her kids feel trapped.
Very difficult because if they want to go out, well, there's always violence within the streets.
The Budget Coalition says city leaders' current budget would slash many public and nonprofit services by 10%, but parts of the Emergency Rental Assistance Program could experience cuts up to 50%. That would impact building code enforcement, housing subsidies, and child care programs.
The situations aren't getting better.
Maria Zamudo is the director of the Housing Rights Committee of San Francisco. It's a community-based organization that helps tenants understand their rights and responsibilities and assists them while working through issues with their landlords before involving the city.
The tenants that we're working with, they are telling us that there are trash in their building, there are pests, there are cockroaches, there are mice, there is mold, there are drafts, there are leaks, right? So all of these things are happening, and without our programs, these issues would only get worse.
She says the city's budget for her organization is projecting a 15% cut. That won't just impact the people who use their services, but also her staff.
Two people who are nonprofit workers here in San Francisco who care about tenants and who don't deserve to be laid off or have their livelihood threatened because the city is deciding to balance the budget on the backs of our programs.
After the rally, many people went inside City Hall to speak at the Board of Supervisors Budget and Appropriations Committee meeting, including Marina Baptista.
sometimes my kids will say to me, Mom, I really, one day we're going to have a bigger space so we can do our homework, a bigger space so we can have space and play.
No action was taken at this meeting, and there will be more meetings before the budget is finalized. People at the rally say they're going to continue to fight.
And the final budget is due June 1st. When asked about the proposed cuts, the mayor's office gave us this statement. They said no final decisions have been made, but with a significant deficit, hard decisions have to be made. They added that the mayor is committed to provide basic city services and critical programs that support the city. Still ahead, two Bay Area women are turning their talents into activism. How they're fighting for a woman's right to choose one baked good at a time.
Is the cake sweeter because you know where the money's going?
I feel better about eating the calories.
And a reminder, you can stream CBS News Bay Area wherever, whenever. Catch all of our live newscasts plus news and weather updates throughout the day. Find us on the free CBS News app or on Pluto TV.
Why are more people turning to KPIX Late Night? Two reasons. Sarah and Stephen. The Late News with Sarah Donchey. Then The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. Back with all new episodes.
Really?
Two shows you'll want to spend the night with.
Then go to sleep knowing you won at TV.
What?
Record it. Stream it. Watch it live. The Late News and the all new Late Show. Weeknights starting at 11 on KPIX.
We have another warm day in the forecast for us throughout the Bay Area with 70s near Oakland, 60s just across the Bay Bridge into San Francisco, and 70s expected all throughout the North Bay into this afternoon. Now the winds are going to continue to move in from the north as that high pressure system sitting just offshore continues to move away. That's been the system that's been bringing us dry weather and above average temperatures pretty much all week long. 80s today near Livermore, 80s all the way down into San Jose. It's a beautiful forecast to get out there and get some fresh air. Now the pollen count is still high, but it's worth noting, if you do have the opportunity to head out there and enjoy some outdoor activities, this is the week to do it. Heading into next week, we have a little bit of a cool down. 80s quickly turning into 70s throughout the rest of this week. Into the weekend forecast, 60s as early as next Tuesday for our inland areas. So it's going to look a lot different and feel a lot different looking outside and heading into our next week's forecast in a similar trend near the bay too. 60s and 70s flirting back and forth with a light chance of showers into next Wednesday's forecast.
Well, abortion access is already a hot topic for political campaigns. It's not only heating up after the recent ruling in Arizona that upholds a 160-year-old law banning nearly all abortions. Supporters and opponents rallied outside the Arizona State Capitol yesterday in response to the Republican-controlled House failing to once again make a repeal to the law.
30 ayes, 30 nays. The ruling of the chair is upheld.
The ban recently revived by Arizona Supreme Court prohibits abortions except to save the life of a pregnant person. Abortion providers could be punished with up to 5 years in prison.
It is time to repeal this abhorrent 1864 abortion ban.
Some of us believe that abortion is in fact the murder of children.
Abortion rights advocates say they have gathered enough signatures to put an initiative on the November ballot that will hope will allow abortion access in Arizona's constitution. And Governor Newsom says California is ready to help people from Arizona in need of reproductive health care. Here in the Bay Area, the threat to abortion rights has inspired people to get involved in some very creative ways. Itai Hod introduces us to two women who are using their baking skills to fight for a woman's right to choose.
In the heart of San Francisco, Nan Wiener is stirring up more than just flour and sugar.
I am making what's called 86-proof chocolate cake.
A retired magazine editor, she's always loved baking. But for the last 2 years, she's been dusting off her old cookbooks for a good cause.
There's many things I care about and work on and follow, but I thought this is the one.
In June of 2022, Nan watched as the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade, ending the right to abortion upheld for decades. At that very moment, she knew she had to rise up and do something. Along with longtime friend Zoe Stricker, she started a neighborhood bake sale, donating the money to organizations that support abortion rights.
The response was unbelievable. People were just so excited, and we sold out.
That's when they decided to turn their half-baked idea into a full-blown cottage business called My Bakery, My Choice. After securing the permits, they began taking orders from customers from all over the Bay, with 100% of the proceeds going to vetted organizations that support abortion rights.
Nice.
Today, they're donating $750 to a nonprofit in Tucson after the Arizona Supreme Court upheld an 1864 law that bans nearly all abortions. But even though they've given more than $10,000 so far, they're not looking to sugarcoat things.
We were asked recently, you know, what's your vision for the future? And I was like, my vision is that we don't have to exist.
Oh my God.
Barbara Grobe drove here all the way from Marin County to pick up a dessert for her family. The fact that it's helping women's rights is just icing on the cake.
Is the cake sweeter because you know where the money's going?
I feel better about eating the calories.
And if you'd like to learn more about My Bakery, My Choice, we posted a link to their website and Itai's story on KPIX.com. Coming up our next half hour on CBS News Bay Area, legit pop businesses struggling to compete with the black market. Now one county agrees it's time to change up the system. And small items making a big impact. We're going to meet the woman behind a hygiene solution helping thousands of people in need.
These are your neighborhoods. This is your world. CBS News Bay Area.
And still ahead on KPI.
With Juliette Goodrich. And the CBS Evening News with Nora O'Donnell. Taking you to the day's top stories. Smart, comprehensive coverage. And immersive weather like you've never seen it. Join Juliette Goodrich and Nora O'Donnell. Weeknights 6 to 7:30 on KPIX.
I'm Ryan Yamamoto. This is The Minute. Google has fired 28 workers after dozens of employees participated in sit-ins at the company's Sunnyvale and New York offices. They were protesting Google's cloud project contract with the Israeli government. 9 employees were arrested on charges of trespassing. Police say a 14-year-old boy is suspected of setting this fire that destroyed a Waymo car in San Francisco's Chinatown neighborhood. This happened back in February during the Lunar New Year festivities. The Juvenile Probation Department now determined if the teen will be arrested. Oakland PD busted an armed robbery of tobacco products. This happened on Mountain Boulevard near Interstate 580. Investigators say it's related to other tobacco-related robberies throughout the Bay Area. So far, 8 arrests have been made. The robberies continue to be investigated. The Bay Area's only primetime newscast, 8 and 9 p.m. on the All in Weeks Plus, 44 Cable to Wild.
The system that's sitting just offshore, keeping us dry and warm, is starting to move a little bit to the south, but we're still getting above average temperatures heading into this afternoon by about 13 degrees just in areas like San Jose. And let's head over to the map real fast. I want to show you what's going on for our daytime highs all throughout the Bay Area. Upper 60s are expected today into San Francisco, with light winds sweeping in from the north to the south. To add to that, we're also expecting above average temperatures off near Livermore and Fremont. Upper 70s and lower 80s there, a similar trend down in the Santa Clara Valley. Now, the more north we go, closer to wine country, well, the more mild it gets, just by a little bit, not by much. 60s in the forecast for us near San Francisco, turns into 70s once you cross that Golden Gate Bridge into North Bay. It's going to be a beautiful one for us this afternoon. And let's take a quick look at what's happening right around the corner when it comes to rain. It's been dry for the past couple days. It has been perfect for any outdoor activities, and we'll continue to see that trend as we head into the next 7 days, with a slight chance of showers as early as next Wednesday. And we're keeping a close eye on that system right now. Looking at the Climate Prediction Center, they're showing wetter than normal conditions expected from our 8 to 14 day outlook. So a little far away, but it's worth noting that that's right around the corner, and that's going to break this dry break that we've had so far this week. 80s and 70s flirting back and forth. That's the forecast for us for our inland areas as we head into our weekend setup. Sunny skies for Sunday, beautiful as could be as we head into the weekend, and dry conditions to kick off next work week too. That's in our inland areas. Once we head to the Bay, closer to San Francisco and Oakland, it'll be just a little bit cooler, not by much though. 60s and 70s still kind of flirting back and forth, with a low 60s by next Wednesday, with that slight chance of showers still off in the distance.
Well, there's another push to legalize magic mushrooms and other drugs in California. Governor Newsom vetoed a bill last year that would have decriminalized certain psychedelics, but now a new scaled-back version focused on therapy is making its way through the legislature. Kenny Choi shows us how this can make a big difference for those with mental health struggles.
Nina Olmsted has struggled with anxiety most of her adult life. Her first ketamine-assisted therapy session proved to be a breakthrough.
It gave me a sense of self-understanding and self-forgiveness that is kind of what I was trying to cultivate through therapy.
Years of traditional therapy and taking anti-anxiety medication didn't work for the Menlo Park resident.
I've just found that, you know, psychedelic therapies and like alternative therapies are a really powerful substitute for those kinds of medications.
Lindsay Olshan is a trained psychedelic-assisted therapist and founder of FADEN, who leads one-on-one ketamine journeys.
We're finding with the psychedelic approach is that people are actually getting into the root cause of a lot of those symptoms and being able to process that fully so that they're not requiring those medicines anymore.
Olshan has cultivated her practice for 20 years, but it was only 4 years ago when she added psychedelic-assisted therapy using ketamine.
It just deepened people's ability to heal. It enriched the therapeutic process. It gave me a more passion for what I'm doing, because it really is feeling like I'm moving the needle with people in a way that has been hard to do.
Prescribed ketamine sessions are legal in California, but the use of psychedelic drugs like hallucinogenic mushrooms and MDMA, commonly known as ecstasy, are not. State Senator Scott Wiener is trying to change that.
It's all in the shadows, because it's technically a crime. And so we're really, our primary goal is just to bring it out of the shadows.
Wiener's years-long push to decriminalize the possession of psychedelic drugs came to an abrupt halt with a veto by Governor Newsom last fall. This revised bill wouldn't make recreational use legal, but rather open the doors for psychedelic-assisted therapists.
We want them to be able to be certified, be out in the sunlight, not have to worry about getting arrested. And that's really one of our goals here.
The California Coalition for Psychedelic Safety and Education, one of the most vocal critics of Wiener's last bill, now supports this latest version.
We felt that the therapeutic regulated access should come first, and then we should learn from that before we explore decriminalizing for recreational use.
I think the impact could be profound in terms of giving people another option to heal and to have that be done in a very regulated, safe environment.
The combination of working with the ketamine and the traditional therapy kind of fused things for me in a way that was really, really impactful.
For Nina Olmsted, the shift she has experienced is enough proof for her.
Well, the bill passed a major committee hearing on Monday. Greg Burt with the California Family Council was among those who testified against it, saying psychedelics could have dangerous reactions.
Seizures, heart issues, anxiety, hallucinations. I mean, psychedelics actually, part of what it does is it makes you lose touch with reality. Now, sometimes people have good reactions with that, but there's a lot of people who have terrible reactions. They think they can fly. They don't know where they are. They have violent reactions to this.
Well, if passed, the bill would establish a licensing board and would require the drug facilitators to hold at least one medical license. Well, we're just a few days away from 420, the unofficial holiday celebrating marijuana, but it's coming at a time when many legal pot businesses are barely squeezing by. California is still the world's largest market for legalized recreational marijuana, but it's been struggling. The state reported just over $5 billion in total cannabis sales last year. That's down for the second year in a row. Now some local counties are realizing legal pot isn't the moneymaker they hoped it would be. Sonoma County just voted to give its businesses a tax break. John Ramos spoke to one grower who says they shouldn't be taxed at all.
When California voted to legalize marijuana, a lot of growers in rural areas like Sonoma County thought this was their chance to go legit. But things didn't quite work out as they expected. And now they say it is the taxes being charged by the county that's driving a lot of cannabis providers back into the shadows.
As he ducks into his Glen Ellen cannabis nursery, Eric Pearson examines the growing stock for next year's crop. When his company Spark began operating, he figured officials were overestimating what the value of cannabis would be to Sonoma County.
The industry is not the pot of gold that they thought it was in 2016 when they began to contemplate these taxes.
That was acknowledged on Tuesday at the Board of Supervisors meeting.
I think that there had been hope that this tax was going to be something that we could use for other things in the county and to be able to make improvements.
Originally, this was going to be a cash cow, and it's not. And that's true for everyone, but be careful what you wish for, I guess.
So the county voted to reduce how much they charge cultivators, in Pearson's case, about 8%. But cannabis is taxed four times in Sonoma County from the time it's grown to the time it's sold. Pearson pays more than $90,000 in taxes for his 3 acres, while the hillsides are covered with grapevines that are not taxed at all.
There's no agricultural crop in Sonoma County that is taxed except cannabis.
New local revenue was one of the selling points for legalization, but when competition caused prices to plummet, the taxes, which remained fixed, began killing off businesses. Now Pearson says there are only a handful of legal operators who are left to compete with those who have returned to the illegal market.
And if they charge us too much money, we can't compete with that. And by default, they end up supporting the illicit market that they're trying to regulate or trying to stamp out, essentially.
If they got rid of all the taxes that are on cannabis right now, would that save the industry?
Yes, absolutely it would.
There may be another reason for getting rid of the taxes completely. It turns out the cost of collection is higher than what little revenues are received, which means by taxing the cannabis growers, the county is actually losing money.
Well, the numbers are not too promising. Last May, there were 155 legal cannabis growers operating in Sonoma County. Now, 1 year later, there are less than half that many. Up next, how well prepared are you for an earthquake? We go over the essential items you need to have in your to-go bag.
I
I would like to see the headlines that the national press picks up on and say, look, there's another side to the Bay Area.
We take those headlines a little step further to sort of connect all these wonderful communities here.
Really embracing the positivity and hopefully spreading it.
The Bay Area is full of some amazing, innovative change makers.
People that are out there making a difference.
In fact, I feel privileged that I get to share those stories.
Wake up with a morning edition, weekdays on KPIX.
Our daytime highs throughout the Bay Area all week long have been sitting above average. But why? Well, high pressure sitting just offshore, keeping us nice and warm and dry too. And looking at the next 7 days, we're going to see a little bit of a cool down. But for now, just enjoy this warm weather while we have it. We're expecting upper 60s once again near San Francisco, with 80s off into the East Bay near Antioch, matching with Livermore, and more 80s in the forecast down into the Santa Clara Valley, lasting into this afternoon.
Well, today we continue to remember the 118 years since San Francisco's great earthquake of 1906. That 7.9 quake caused quite the devastation all across the city. Coming out of that damage, concrete became the key tool to construct buildings, some of which are still around today. Since we live close to the fault lines, we'll never really be out of the woods, and at some point someday, we're going to have another earthquake. Our Brian Hackney talked to some experts on what your prep should look like when the big one happens.
My close associate, family therapist, Dr. Tara Fields.
Dr. Tara Fields is a licensed marriage and family therapist.
Look at this still as a choice.
Dr. Fields has spent a career asking tough questions.
Are you in or are you out?
I paid her a visit.
Hi.
To see if she could answer one.
Where's your earthquake preparedness bag?
Oh my God, you just put me down the shame spiral, or you just saved my life. And my dog's life.
Well, come on in.
Turns out Tara and her husband are kind of prepared.
See the armoire where all my china is? We have the earthquake retrofitting kit with the straps, but it hasn't been installed.
How long have you had the kit?
A few years. I think I should get partial credit for being prepared.
Dr. Fields does have the basics.
Medication, I have cash. I have anything that I would need for 24 hours.
You know where to turn your gas off if there's a gas leak?
Yes, about a year ago, I had my husband go through, how do you turn off the gas? How do you, you know, all those major things.
For a more complete list of what Tara should have on hand, seismologist Ross Stein.
Cheers, been too long.
A complete earthquake kit would look like this.
It's got a lot of water. It's got a mask, a cold pack, heat packs, lithium batteries, a flashlight here, a utility knife. You need to be able to cut things.
That looks appetizing.
This brick is food. I'm not going to vouch for the quality, but it's got to be filling because it weighs a ton. And the most important thing is, look, it all fits in a backpack. You throw it in your trunk of your car, and it's there when you need it.
This is all the practical stuff.
Coffee. I got to have coffee.
You think that you're ready. You think you have all these practical steps.
Oh, my God, we're having an earthquake. Wait a minute. Hold on.
But when you're running a lot of stress hormones.
Can you feel that?
It's very hard to think clearly.
So you should be prepared mentally as well. And there's one big thing that can help. Just take a breath.
It's wonderful for any kind of anxiety. You breathe in for four, through the nose, you hold for four, and then you exhale for eight.
Oh, and guess what we found?
Wait a minute, Brian Hackney. You may have saved the day. I had no idea where it was.
Now's the time to get ready.
Well, coming up, this week's Jefferson Award winner is making an effort to help with hygiene.
What was so telling to me was how many of the people calling in a crisis were not able to meet their very basic needs.
We have another warm day in the forecast for us throughout the Bay Area with 70s near Oakland, 60s just across the Bay Bridge into San Francisco, and 70s expected all throughout the North Bay into this afternoon. Now the winds are going to continue to move in from the north as that high pressure system sitting just offshore continues to move away. That's been the system that's been bringing us dry weather and above average temperatures pretty much all week long. 80s today near Livermore, 80s all the way down into San Jose. It's a beautiful forecast to get out there and get some fresh air. Now the pollen count is still high, but it's worth noting, if you do have the opportunity to head out there and enjoy some outdoor activities, this is the week to do it. Heading into next week, we have a little bit of a cool down. 80s quickly turning into 70s throughout the rest of this week into the weekend forecast. 60s as early as next Tuesday for our inland areas. So it's going to look a lot different and feel a lot different looking outside and heading into our next week's forecast in a similar trend near the bay too. 60s and 70s flirting back and forth with a light chance of showers into next Wednesday's forecast.
Well, Stanford formally announced Kate Pay as the new head coach of Stanford's women's basketball team. Pay is replacing Tara Vanderveer, the legendary coach announced her retirement last week. Pay has worked as Vanderveer's assistant for 17 seasons. Already, she knows the drill. Our Vern Glenn spoke with Pay yesterday about her excitement.
Is your head spinning right now?
It's been a wild 24 hours, Vern, yeah. But certainly, I know it'll be a lot different, and I feel extremely well prepared for it, but I know I'll have a lot to learn. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, we're really excited that all of our staff is coming back. We all love Stanford. We love being here. We mm-hmm. love working with the student athletes on our team. You know, I've had the opportunity to watch, like, Chinee take over for NECA, mm-hmm. so, you know, now it's my turn to step up. And I know with our staff and our team, we all have each other's back, and we're excited about doing what we do, which is to roll up our sleeves and get to work.
Well, a San Francisco-based nonprofit helps low-income and unsheltered people stay healthy and feel good about themselves. The program's founder says the items she gives away are small, but they make a big difference. Sharon Chin introduces us to this week's Bay Area Jefferson Award winner.
Through Megan Freebeck's nonprofit, 3 million hygiene products have gone out to people in need.
Megan Freebeck and her volunteers got inspired to pack toiletries to give away after she encountered a troubling trend several years ago while heading up San Francisco's suicide prevention.
What was so telling to me was how many of the people calling in a crisis were not able to meet their very basic needs.
So Megan launched Simply the Basics in 2016, a nationwide nonprofit that gives hygiene products for free to people who are low income or unhoused. The so-called hygiene bank considers that one size does not fit all, that children need different sized diapers, and people with sensitive teeth need special toothpaste.
So it was very clear to us that while we've got this incredible food distribution system in the country, that you can get nutritious food and food for different dietary needs, we did not have that for hygiene.
Simply the Basics sends the hygiene care items to more than 200 community partners to distribute. The San Francisco-based nonprofit also hosts public markets.
Toothbrushes, we could do that.
And individuals can reach out, like one woman who called herself Deja. She came in and got help choosing what she wanted.
Everybody needs hygiene stuff, you know, basic stuff to take care of themselves. So it's a really good thing.
Which brand is your go-to?
Megan says the privately funded donations fill more than just a physical need. People tell her that taking care of themselves means they can focus on other goals like sobriety, housing, and relationships.
Tooth decay has reduced, which we know leads to heart disease, so we're preventing things like that. All the way to somebody finding employment because they felt confident going into a job for the first time. And some of my favorite stories truly are people who say, I visited my grandchildren for the first time in months and felt comfortable, you know, letting my grandkid climb on me and hug me.
Simply the Basics hygiene products have reached 200 cities. Volunteer and board member Jillian Knox credits the nonprofit's growth to Megan's compassion for others.
She's like an actual superwoman, like doing amazing things. And she puts her heart in it and you can just tell.
It's really insurmountable what we're able to do, what a person is able to do when they are able to feel clean and healthy.
Oh, sweetie.
So for creating a national hygiene bank for better health, this week's Jefferson Award in the Bay Area goes to Megan Freebeck.
And Simply the Basics has also sent hygiene kits to disaster areas from California wildfires to emergencies in Honduras and Ukraine. And you can nominate your local hero for a Jefferson Award online at kpix.com/hero. Well, thanks for streaming CBS News Bay Area. I'm Ryan Yamamoto. We'll be right back with your First Alert forecast and a look at your top stories. Yamamoto. This is The Men, an investigation now underway into a deadly police shooting in Oakland. A homicide suspect was shot during an arrest involving Sacramento PD. It happened at a home at 16 and Adeline Streets when they say the man came out pointing a gun. The officers involved are now on administrative leave. A Livermore family was involved in a deadly crash in the Central Valley. CHP says the driver lost control, rolling over the van, and it caught fire. People ran out of their homes and cars to flip that van. Three children were rescued and are now in the hospital. The mom and dad and two children died at the scene. Well, today, remember 118 years ago on the anniversary of the San Francisco's great earthquake of 1906. This morning, city leaders and first responders held a commemoration event at Lotus Fountain on Market Street, where a wreath-laying ceremony was dedicated to the memory of the late Senator Dianne Feinstein. Brian Yamamoto, this is The Men.
The system that's sitting just offshore, keeping us dry and warm, is starting to move a little bit to the south, but we're still getting above average temperatures heading into this afternoon by about 13 degrees just in areas like San Jose. And let's head over to the map real fast. I want to show you what's going on for our daytime highs all throughout the Bay Area. Upper 60s are expected today into San Francisco, with light winds sweeping in from the north to the south. To add to that, we're also expecting above average temperatures off near Livermore and Fremont. Upper 70s and lower 80s there, a similar trend down in the Santa Clara Valley. Now, the more north we go, closer to wine country, well, the more mild it gets, just by a little bit, not by much. 60s in the forecast for us near San Francisco, turns into 70s once you cross that Golden Gate Bridge into North Bay. It's going to be a beautiful one for us this afternoon. And let's take a quick look at what's happening right around the corner when it comes to rain. It's been dry for the past couple days. It has been perfect for any outdoor activities, and we'll continue to see that trend as we head into the next 7 days with a slight chance of showers as early as next Wednesday. And we're keeping a close eye on that system right now. Looking at the Climate Prediction Center, they're showing wetter than normal conditions expected from our 8 to 14 day outlook. So a little far away, but it's worth noting that that's right around the corner, and that's going to break this dry break that we've had so far this week. 80s and 70s flirting back and forth. That's the forecast for us for our inland areas as we head into our weekend setup. Sunny skies for Sunday, beautiful as could be as we head into the weekend, and dry conditions to kick off next work week too. That's in our inland areas. Once we head to the Bay, closer to San Francisco and Oakland, it'll be just a little bit cooler, not by much though. 60s and 70s still kind of flirting back and forth, with a low 60s by next Wednesday with that slight chance of showers still off in the distance.
Well, these light poles around Oakland's Lake Mare look pretty unremarkable. They're green and more than 100 years old. So unremarkable, though, you had never guessed that they are actually a hot commodity for thieves. And as Katie Nielsen shows us, they are so desperate for copper, some thieves are actually digging them out of the ground, and that's creating a big problem for the city.
We live here, you know what I mean?
Michael Stadler lives only a few blocks from Lake Merritt and works from home most of the time, which is why he comes down to the lake sometimes twice a day.
Sunshine, a little bit of nature, and then the people. And I really like being around the people, and just it makes me feel like kind of part of the community.
But recently, he and others who regularly walk or run around the lake have noticed some of the light posts and string lights are missing.
I think I would feel more comfortable if the lights were up, but also my wife likes to run really early in the morning, and I think that does concern me more. I think I'm generally more concerned about her. Lighted spaces always seem safer. I think dark spaces just seem like places you can get away with stuff more.
There are 126 lampposts holding up more than 4,000 string lights that wrap around the more than 3-mile lake. They were first installed in 1925 and are affectionately called the Necklace of Lights.
The lake is our crown jewel, and I do remember when they put up the lights, and it was so beautiful, and I love driving by it, and it's magical.
Maureen Molman is a volunteer with the Lake Merritt Breakfast Club, a community group that cares for the lake and the Necklace of Lights.
I took great pride in them, and then when I started noticing they were down, I was very traumatized.
Yep.
Oakland Public Works employees were out at the lake putting up temporary poles and lights. The city says a total of 10 original poles are damaged or missing. Some of the poles came down when trees fell on the lights during recent storms. Others were vandalized, cut off at the base, and wires have been ripped out or damaged from 34 curb electrical boxes, possibly to steal the copper.
And in order to replace the light poles, the city has to have them custom made at a price of about $15,000 apiece. Well, the San Francisco Sheriff's Department is lifting the lockdown at a city jail. The facility on 7th Street has seen a spike in violence, and so has the jail in San Bruno. Partial lockdown is still in place at that facility. is expected to be lifted sometime this week. And on our morning edition, San Francisco Sheriff Paul Miyamoto spoke about the decision to lock those down and why they are now being lifted.
I think part of it is that as we moved on from the pandemic and gotten into normalcy in the jails just as much as we have in the community, there's a reflection of that in the behaviors that we see now. We've had an increase in violence against our staff, completely focused on our people. And the lockdowns are a way in that system in which we kind of calm things down, bring things back together, have the opportunity to investigate to make sure they're not tied to larger issues in terms of our housing units, and move on from there to keep people safe.
Are low staffing levels an issue when it comes to this?
Low staffing levels are definitely a challenge for us, but most of these attacks, and usually when deputies are assaulted, it's a one-on-one thing. They're targeting deputies, they're targeting individuals one-on-one. Some of these assaults have occurred with other deputies present as well and other staff. Our response times in the jails in terms of getting